ज्ञानांजन शलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्री चैतन्य मनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपा गदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकम्। हे कृष्ण कर्ण सिंधु दीनबंधु जगतपते गोपेश गोपिका कांथा राधा कांथा नमस्तुते। तप्त कांचन गौरंगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी विश्वानुस्ते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंदा श्री अद्वैत गदाधार शिव साधि गौर भक्त वृंदा। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। सो इट्स अ डिटेल्ड क्लास। वेलकम टू द सीरीज ऑफ आईसोपनिषद लेक्चर्स। सो वी आर एक्चुअली गोइंग टू बी रीडिंग आईसोपनिषद टुगेदर एज वेल। इट्स गोइंग टू बी Mataji, Sita Mataji, may I request you to send the invitation for Isopanishad again in Isopanishad group, the WhatsApp group. Some yes, people Mataji. Have joined now. Thank you. Okay, I'm also doing it for the first time, preaching Isopanishad. I have not done it. Let's see how it goes. By Prabhupada's mercy. Let's bring it up. Isopanishad has 18 mantras plus invocation plus introduction. So invocation mantra is so 19 and introduction so 20. So 20, around 16 to 18 classes are needed to do this. I'm going to present a very small PPT and then we will basically be reading. I made them today. They are not available to you in Teachable yet. You have to give me some time before I can make it available to all of you. So very small, and then we're going to read. All of you have Isopanishad book. We sent it out. Does all of you have it? I think I can ask you all to. Okay, you can unmute and tell me. You all have it?
Yes, Mataji. Yes,
Mataji.
Yes, Mataji.
Mataji.
Yes, Mataji.
No, ma'am, I don't have.
Yes, Mataji.
No, Mataji.
No, ma'am, I don't have.
So, whoever is saying no, we have shared the soft copy in your WhatsApp group. Please download it from there.
Sure, I will check it. Thank you.
Thank you, my Krishna.
Okay.
So, Isopanishad is based on Prabhupada's teaching, is in the teachings of His Divine Grace, it's Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. Let's pay our obeisances to Sri Radha Govinda. Only by their mercy will I be able to speak or understand, because it's not possible otherwise. All this is under Namanishtha Prabhu's supervision. He's very aware that I'm doing this and he gave me His blessings. Whenever this lockdown is lifted, please try to visit. And if you call ahead, then we'll be able to arrange for your stay in our small little guest house there. So Isopanishad introduction, this is what we'll do today. In introduction, Srila Prabhupada emphasizes the importance of Vedic knowledge and why it is necessary to accept it. What is Vedic knowledge and what is so special about it in our life? And Vedas are taken specifically and in general. And then in the introduction, so these two things are covered. In invocation and verses 1 to 3, generally they go together, but I'm going to go slow. Generally when we do Bhakti Shastri, introduction and invocation go together and verses 1 to 3 go together, but I'll read it up. So perfection through acting in one's relationship with Krishna. Isopanishad is based on Sambandha, as we will read in some time. Sambandha means relationship between living entity and Krishna. Isopanishad is full of nectar of who is Krishna and who is living entity and what is the relationship between the two. And also we get to know the benefits of working in Ishavasya consciousness. Ishavasya consciousness means who is the supreme proprietor of everything around us. Ishavasyam idam sarvam. So we have to recognize, ultimately, one should be able to recognize, should be, I'm using that word, that Krishna is the supreme proprietor. And we have to, once we recognize, then one has to work in that consciousness. So the recognition itself that Krishna is the proprietor and I am the subordinate itself is is a subjugate topic of sambandha in Vedas. If you all remember, because I hope you all have done, 18 days at least once. So in that, sambandha, avideya, and prayojan was described more than one time in 10 chapter, in 15 chapter, and a bit in 9 chapter, a bit. So is sambandha, avideya, prayojan, and also, 15 I said. So when we realize that who is God and who is who am I and what is my relationship, then we have to work in that consciousness and then fade of those who work, who fail to recognize the Lord's proprietorship. This is all discussed in first 3 verses and invocation. And then for verse 4-8, the inconceivable Lord can only be known by Mahabhagavata. Then 9-11, comparing the cultivation of knowledge in his science. And verse 12-14 will be comparing knowledge of absolute to worship of the relative. And 15-19 are the prayers for the revelation of the Lord's spiritual form. There are 7 prominent topics which are discussed in Isopanishad. One is called knowledge, epistemology. Epistemology means differentiating the opinion from with a base, with a foundation. It's like one opinion is coming from someone's mind and then there is another opinion which is made based on some evidence. So Isopanishad teaches us how to make an opinion according in the Vedic Shastras based on the reference of the Vedas, of the Shastras. Okay, so this is discussed. Prabhupada teaches us with many, many references throughout the book. Then the other topic which is discussed is the living entities, and then spiritualism versus materialism. And we defeat impersonalism many times. Bhakti is discussed, absolute truth is discussed, and Ishavasya principle is discussed. Okay, so introduction. In the introduction, Srila Prabhupada will establish the definition of the Vedas. So by the end of reading what we're going to read now, you should be able to understand the in definition of the Vedas and need to take guidance from the Vedas. So Isopanishad is directly Vedic literature, being part of the Shruti. So Shruti Praman, Smriti Praman, these all will come. It will come. I know many of you are anxious to know the difference between Puranas, Itihas, Vedas, and Isopanishad. It will come. So introduction, the Shruti is considered to be like a mother. We take so much knowledge from our mother. For example, if you want to know who your father is, who can answer you? Your mother. This is Srila Prabhupada's snippet I took. Similarly, if you want to know something beyond your experience, beyond your experimental knowledge, beyond the activities of the senses, then you have to accept the Vedas. This is a big chart. I will explain it a little bit later. But in short, Vedic knowledge is divided into 2 parts, Shruti and Smriti. Smriti is by memory. Smriti was for people before Kali Yuga who had such a sharp memory that once they will hear from the mouth of the spiritual master, they will memorize. There was no need for any writings. So Smriti has all these 5 subdivisions. But Vedavyas knew. Vedavyas knew that the people in Kali Yuga are going to have short memory. They will need something in writing. So then he wrote down. So he divided the Vedic knowledge into 4 Vedas. Rig, Yajur, Sama, and Atharva Veda. Sorry. And then in Vedas, and then he further divided into Samhitas, in Brahmanas, in Aranyakas, and in Upanishads. Okay. What happens is Vedic knowledge is based on karmakand, means collect do activity for achieving something fruitive result. But Upanishads are based on jnana, so it lifts a living entity who is more serious and inclined from karmakand section to jnana, and that part is called Upanishads. And going further, jnanas should ultimately lead to bhakti, surrender to Krishna. So I'm going to pause here and then we're actually going to read the book. I hope all of you have this book. If you don't, then you need to. Siddha Mataji has been religiously sharing it in all the WhatsApp groups. If you still don't have it, then you got to let us know. So, Meera Mataji, why is your hand raised? Okay, Rupa Mataji, would you, yes, tell me.
No, no, I just wanted to read the same sloka, so I just thought if you're
okay,
asking me to read it. Okay.
Okay, why don't you read introduction to the teachings of Veda. This was delivered okay. as a lecture by His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada okay. on October 6, 1969 at Conway Hall, London, England. So we'll read. If we can finish this today, because if you have a good base in Aisopanishad, because Aisopanishad is going to build. In the middle section, it gets a little bit tricky. Vedic knowledge language is very tricky. So pay attention, please, to the lecture that Prabhupada gave. Okay, Mataji, go ahead. And then Rupa Mataji will read later. Please.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Ladies and gentlemen, today's subject matter is the teachings of the Vedas. What are the Vedas? The Sanskrit verbal root of Veda can be interpreted variously, but the purport is finally one. Veda means knowledge. Any knowledge you accept is Veda, for the teachings of the Vedas are the original knowledge. In the conditioned state, our knowledge is subjected to many deficiencies. The difference between a conditioned soul and the liberated soul is that the conditioned soul has four kinds of defects. The first defect is that he must commit mistakes. For example, in our country, Mahatma Gandhi was considered to be a very great personality, but he committed many mistakes. Even at last stage of his life, his assistant warned Mahatma Gandhi, "Don't go to New Delhi meeting. I have some friends and I have heard this danger." But he did not hear. He persisted in going and was killed. Even great personalities like Mahatma Gandhi, President Kennedy, there are so many of them make mistakes. To err is human. This is one of the defects of the conditioned soul. Another defect, to be illusioned. Illusion means to accept something which is not. Maya. Maya means what is not. Everyone is accepting the body as the self. If I ask you what you are, you will say, "I am Mr. John, I am a rich man, I am this, I am that." All these are bodily identifications. But you are not this body. This is illusion. The third defect is the cheating propensity. Everyone has the propensity to cheat others. Although a person is fool number one, he possesses himself as very intelligent, poses himself as very intelligent. Although it is already pointed out that he is an illusion and makes mistakes, he is theorized. "I think this is this, this is this." But he does not even know his own position. He writes books of the philosophy, although he is defective. That is his disease. That is cheating. Lastly, our senses are imperfect. We are very proud of our eyes. Often someone will challenge, "Can you show me God?" But do you have the eyes to see God? You will never see if you haven't the eyes. If immediately the room becomes dark, you cannot even see your hands. So what power do you have to see? We can't therefore expect knowledge, Veda, with these imperfect senses. With all these deficiencies in conditioned life, we cannot give perfect knowledge to anyone. Nor are we ourselves perfect. Therefore, we accept the Vedas as they are. You may call
Mataji, Mataji, let's take a break. Thank you. Thank you very much. So, Prabhupada is teaching us two things here. One is what is the meaning of the word Vedas? Veda means knowledge. So, and then what is the difference between the conditioned soul and the liberated soul? The conditioned soul has four defects. So what are the four defects? Number one, this is going to be a question at the end. So please, number one is must commit mistake. Number two, must be illusion. Number three, cheating propensity. And number four, senses are imperfect. And Prabhupada is giving analogies that illusion means, commit mistakes. We all commit mistakes. You say to err is human, right? But a liberated soul or Vedic knowledge has no mistake. There is no mistake. That is why it is perfect. And to be illusion means taking something for something else. Like we are taking ourselves as a body, but we are not the body. So we have this basic identity crisis from the get-go. So how can we give the perfect knowledge? And the third defect is cheating propensity. There is a cheating propensity in every conditioned soul. Krishna also has a cheating propensity. He also cheats his mother. She asks him, did you eat butter in the neighborhood? And he says no. So, but that cheating propensity is celebrated. That's in its pure form. Because Krishna has it, that is why everyone else has these qualities. Okay, but we are now perverted. These qualities are now perverted. They are contaminated. Krishna stealing is celebrated. But stealing in conditioned world is punishable. So we must understand our position in relation to Krishna. We cannot say, oh, Krishna did this, so I can do that. No. And our senses are imperfect. We cannot see so many things. For example, this coronavirus going on, how many of us have seen it? We have not seen it with our eyes. We have only heard about it and we are believing it, right? Or we have only seen the effects of it, but we have not seen the virus itself. So our senses are very imperfect. So how can we have the perfect knowledge if we are so imperfect in all these things? So Prabhupada is trying to establish that Vedic knowledge has to be accepted as it is. Okay. So please remember two things from the first section of the lecture. What is the definition of the Vedas and what are the four defects of our living entity? Why don't someone tell me what are the four defects of the living entity? Next time I will just make a slideshow if you all read and come. Yes, please raise your hand quickly. What are the four defects that Srila Prabhupada is saying? And you can write it to me also. Yes, Kirti Mataji, what are the four defects?
Making mistakes, cheating propensity, illusion.
Uh-huh.
I forgot the last one.
Okay, no problem. So we're going to have someone help you out. So please tell the one that she's missing, Poona Mataji.
Mataji, first is commit mistake, second illusion, third is cheating propensity, and the fourth is sense are imperfect.
When senses are imperfect. Thank you very much. Thank you both of you. Okay, now Prabhupada is going to slash in the second part of the lecture, the Vedas and Hindu. What is the meaning of the word Hindu? Rupa Mataji, may I request you to read?
Yes, Mataji, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
You may call the Vedas Hindu, but Hindu is a foreign name. We are not Hindus. Our real identification is Varnashrama. Varnashrama denotes the followers of the Vedas, those who accept the human society in eight divisions of Varna and Ashrama. There are four divisions of society.
Mataji,
and
can
four
you read,
divisions of
can you
spiritual
life. Read little slow? You're reading a little fast, please.
Okay, Mataji. This is called Varnashrama. It is stated in the Bhagavad Gita 4.13. These divisions are everywhere because they are created by God. The divisions of society are Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. Brahmana refers to the very intelligent class of men, those who know what is Brahman. Similarly, the Kshatriyas, the administrator group, are the next intelligent class of men. Then the Vaishyas, the mercantile group. These natural classifications are found everywhere. This is the Vedic principle and we accept it. Vedic principles are accepted as axiomatic truth, for there cannot be any mistake. That is acceptance. For instance, in India, cow dung is accepted as pure and that cow dung is a stool of an animal. In one place, you will find the Vedic injunctions that if you touch stool, you have to take a bath immediately. But in another place, it is said that the stool of a cow is pure. If you smear cow dung in an impure place, that place becomes pure. With our ordinary sense, we can argue this is contradictory. Actually, it is contradictory from the ordinary point of view, but it is not false. It is fact. In Calcutta, A very prominent scientist and doctor analyzed cow dung and found that it contains all antiseptic properties.
One second, Mataji. One second. So Prabhupada is saying that Veda Hindu is a foreign name. Actually, there was a river called Sindhu. And in English rule, in the eastern part of the world, they started calling people who used to live on the eastern side of the river Sindhu as Hindu. So Hindu word is not a Shastric word at all. It is a man-made word. And Prabhupada explains the origin of the word as people who were living on the eastern side of the river Sindhu. The English people started calling those people as Hindu. It's a foreign word. Actually, the word is Varna Ashrama. So Varna Ashrama is, Varna means occupation, and Ashrama means the spiritual order. So there is one occupational order, which is Varna, means based on what work I do, whether I am situated as Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, or Shudra. This is the Varna. Whether I'm working as a Brahmana, in 18th chapter Bhagavad Gita, we discussed there are nine qualities assigned to a Brahmana. 7 to a Kshatriya, 4 to a Vaishya, 1 to a Shudra. That's Varna. Ashrama means spiritual order. Whether I'm situated in Brahmachari Ashram, Grihastha Ashram, Vanaprastha Ashram, or Sannyas Ashram. That is the division of the society. If you remember from 4th chapter also, there's no division according to caste and color. There's no division according to birth. It is based on what is my inclination to work and what is my spiritual order in that correspondence. Okay, so the basic fundamental basis on which the whole world is functioning is false right now. That is why there's so much chaos. No one is following the Vedic Shastras. Everyone is following some man-made thing or mental concoction. If we are able to bring about this, even in a small sample of the world, then people will become very happy and we can be a set sample. That's what Srila Prabhupada wants. Srila Prabhupada wants to establish Varnashrama system. So four divisions, I explained this. So Vedic knowledge is axiomatic truth and it cannot be taken as a mistake. Axiomatic truth means we cannot experiment it. We have to accept it, practice it, and then we realize it. Like Prabhupada is saying, cow dung is the stool is a contaminated thing. It's a refuse, but cow dung is accepted as pure. Now, how are you going to prove that? Not everyone can prove, so just accept it. Cow dung is used in the deity room, especially in India. If you go to Vrindavan, the cow dung is used to keep the room very cold in hot weather and hot in cold weather. It has dual function. This is contradictory from the aspect of the vision of the material knowledge, but it is not. So far, what did we discuss? What is Vedas? What are the four kind of defects of a conditioned soul? And also that Vedic knowledge is considered to be an axiomatic truth and there is nothing called Hindus. It's a man-made word. Okay, Mataji, I think you can continue reading for a little bit more.
Yes, Mataji. In India, if one person tells another, you must do this, the other party may say, what do you mean? Is this a Vedic injunction that I have to follow you without any argument? Vedic injunctions cannot be interpreted. But ultimately, if you carefully study why these injunctions are there, you'll find that they are all correct. The Vedas are not compilations of human knowledge. Vedic knowledge comes from the spiritual world, from Lord Krishna. Another name for the Vedas is Shruti. Shruti refers to that knowledge which is acquired by hearing. It is not experimental knowledge. Shruti is considered to be like a mother. We take so much knowledge from our mother. For example, if you want to know who your father is, you can who can answer you? Your mother. If the mother says, here is your father, you have to accept it. It is not possible to experiment to find out whether he is your father. Similarly, if you want to know something beyond your experience, beyond your experimental knowledge, beyond the activities of the senses, then you have to accept the Vedas. There is no question of experimenting. It has already been experimented. It is already settled. The version of the mother, for instance, has to be accepted as truth. There is no other way. The Vedas are considered to be the mother and Brahma is called the grandfather, the forefather, because he was the first to be instructed in the Vedic knowledge. In the beginning, the first living creature was Brahma. He received this Vedic knowledge and imparted it to Narada and other disciples and sons, and they also distributed it to their disciples. In this way, the Vedic knowledge comes down by disciplic succession. It is also confirmed in the Bhagavad Gita that Vedic knowledge is understood in this way. If you make experimental endeavor, you come to the same conclusion, but just to save time, you should accept. If you want to know who your father is, and if you accept your mother as the authority, then whatever she says can be accepted without argument. There are three kinds of evidence: Pratyaksha, Anumana, and Shabda. Pratyaksha means direct evidence. Direct evidence is not very good because our senses are not perfect. We are seeing the sun daily and it appears to us just like a small disk, but it is actually far, far larger than many planets. Of what value is this seeing? Therefore, we have to read books. Then we can understand about the sun. So direct experience is not perfect. Then there is Anumana, inductive knowledge. It may be like this, hypothesis. For instance, Darwin's theory says it may be like this, it may be like that, but that is not science. That is a suggestion and it is also not perfect. But if you receive the knowledge from the authoritative sources, that is perfect. If you receive a program guide from the radio station authorities, you accept it. If you don't deny it, you don't have to make an experiment because it is received from the authoritative sources. Vedic knowledge is called Shabda Pramana. Another name is Shruti. Shruti means that this knowledge has to be received simply by oral reception. The Vedas instruct that in order to understand transcendental knowledge, we have to hear from the authority. Transcendental knowledge is knowledge from beyond this universe. Within this universe is material knowledge, and beyond this universe is transcendental knowledge. We cannot even go to the end of the universe, so how can we go to the spiritual world? Thus, to acquire full knowledge is impossible.
Mataji, thank you. Thank you so much. So you read very well. So what did we discuss in the first section? What are Vedas? Vedas mean knowledge. And then we discussed the four defects of a conditioned soul. And then what did we discuss? That Vedas are axiomatic truth. Axiomatic truth means we cannot accept it. So Prabhupada is, we just have to hear it. We cannot experiment it. We cannot see it. We just have to accept it. We have to hear it and accept it. That is the meaning of the word axiomatic truth. Axiomatic truth is something which is beyond our perception. So Srila Prabhupada is explaining that according to this, the Namanishna Prabhu put a presentation about different types of acquiring knowledge in batch 9, one of the classes. I saw Anuman Praman, Shabda Praman, and Shruti Praman. Anyway, so Prabhupada is telling that there are three ways of acquiring knowledge. What are the three ways? Pratyaksha Praman. This is going to be another question for all of you. Pratyaksha Praman means direct. Seeing is believing. If I don't see it, I don't believe it, it does not exist. That is called one way of acquiring knowledge. But that knowledge is imperfect because our senses are imperfect. Our seeing is imperfect. So the knowledge which is acquired by seeing is also imperfect. Anuman Praman is inductive knowledge, like hypothesizing. For example, if I'm sitting here and behind me a train passes. Now I can hypothesize whether the train is coming towards me or whether the train is going away from me based on the sound wave, right? If it is coming towards me, the sound will increase. If it is going away from me, the sound will decrease. But that I'm inductive, that I'm like, you know, thinking about it. Or if I'm cooking in the kitchen, in a pressure cooker, oh, so three whistles came, the food must be cooked. So let me turn the gas off. That is also Anuman. I'm not seeing what's inside the cooker. I'm estimating, or inductive knowledge. And Prabhupada is giving example of Darwin's theory of evolution. Darwin's theory of evolution has many defects. Darwin's theory of evolution is not scientific. Darwin's theory of evolution says, we can talk about it so many times. It says, for instance, that man came from animal, right? The chimpanzees. So man evolved So one species evolves into another species in course of time. Very well. So if a monkey has evolved into a man, then why are they both coexisting? Monkeys have evolved into man. Why are they coexisting? So it's just an idea. It's a hypothesis. It's not science. So that also is, that paradigm is also rejected. So what is Vedic knowledge? Vedic knowledge is Shabda Brahman. Hear it. And in Bhagavad Gita also, Krishna says to Arjuna so many times, that's Shrinu. Hear it. Hear it. So Vedas instruct that in order to understand transcendental knowledge, we have to hear it from the authority. Now, Prabhupada is going to teach us who is the authority. It's not that we can just, you know, tune in to any radio station and whatever thing they're saying in the name of the Vedic knowledge is what we accept. No. Okay, so we have to find out an authority. And how to find out an authority? An authority is a person, is a bona fide spiritual master, is a person who is in a disciplic succession. Okay, one cannot be a self-acclaimed guru. There is no evidence of self-acclaimed guru anywhere in the Shastras. Anywhere. You read Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Imam Vivaspate Yogam Proktavahanava Aham Avyayam Vivasvan Manave Brahmanurikshava Kave Brabit. So, for chapter, he establishes that I spoke this to Vivasvan. And then Vivasvan spoke it to his son Manu, and Manu spoke it to his son Ikshvaku. Ikshvaku king brought it to earth, gave it to saintly kings, right? So he's giving a disciplic succession. Or if you read Srimad Bhagavatam, there also disciplic succession. Parikshit Maharaj is hearing Suta Goswami. Suta Goswami is also in a disciplic succession. Or anyone who's hearing, Prahlad Maharaj was hearing Narad Muni. Can you give me some examples of from the Srimad Bhagavatam or scriptures where one particular devotee was hearing from their spiritual master and the spiritual master was belonging to some disciplic succession? Give me an example. Anywhere. Now some hands are raised from before, so I don't know. Uma Mataji, yes.
Vyasadev gave it to his son Sukadev.
Goswami. Okay, yeah, we can say that. Yeah, thank you, Mataji. Priya Darshani, Mataji, Hare Krishna. You can type it to me as well. Sukadev Goswami to Parikshit. No, Suta Goswami spoke to Parikshit. No, Sukadev Goswami. Correct. Sukadev Goswami to Parikshit. Priya Darshani, Mataji. Mataji, you're not audible. Yes,
Vandana Mataji. Narad to Vyasadev.
Narad to Vyasadev, very nice. Yes, Priya V. Mataji, more example. Priya B. Mataji.
Yes, Mataji, like Dandavat Pranam. Dhruv Maharaj from Narada. Narada.
Very nice, Dandavat Pranam. Hi, Krishna. Kailash Shah, Prabhu. Yes, Prabhu, what's your example? Okay, Bimla Mataji, Hare Krishna. What's your example?
Hare Krishna is Ved Vyas to Sukhdev ji.
Ved Vyas to Sukhdev Goswami, correct. Okay, yes, Hare Krishna. Yeah. Yes, Gopal Prabhu. What's your example? Pooja Mataji, Pooja Mazukuri Mataji.
Mataji, Krishna to Arjuna.
Krishna to Arjuna, yes, very nice, okay. Thank you. Jalpa Mataji, yes.
Mataji, Krishna to Brahma.
Krishna to Brahma, very good, yes. And then there are some more examples here. God Apada to Adi Shankar, I don't know that, but okay. Kapil Muni to his mother Devahuti, very nice. Narad Muni, very nice. So you all are devotees. So Pratyaksha Praman, Anuman Praman, and Shabda Praman. The topmost level, so tell me which is the topmost level of topmost method of achieving knowledge? Which is the topmost? Sukadev Goswami to Suta Goswami. Yes, that is correct. I'm just gonna, after you answer, please lower your hands because it makes me feel it's harder for me to figure out whether they are new or. Yes, Sapna Hare Krishna. Yes, what is the best way of acquiring knowledge?
Shabda Praman.
Shabda Brahman. Very nice. So, thank you, Sapna. So, we pay heavy fees to go to colleges, schools. Why do we pay? So that we can hear an authority. Hearing is so important. Actually, sound vibration. We should do this workshop next time. If you remind me, today I'm going to take it light. Next time I'll be a little bit more strict. Okay. So sound vibration, how it molds the personality of a person, how it molds the way the direction of one's life. We need to figure it out. So we did this. I did this with one of the batches. I don't know if any one of you was a part of it. This little bit small experiment of how sound vibration has molded our own life. So what are the three modes of acquiring knowledge? Prataksha Praman, Anuman Praman, Shabda Praman. Prataksha Praman means directly seeing is believing, which is defective because the eyes are defective. Anuman Praman, inductive theory, that is not science. It is also defective because Anuman can be defective. One's estimation can also be defective. And Shabda Praman is the Praman that is bona fide, but one has to choose the authority. We cannot say that, oh, I heard from this person, that person, or for instance, hearing Hare Krishna Mahamantra. If we hear Hare Krishna Mahamantra from the lips of a non-devotee, person who is not austere, and we try to follow them, then the mantra will not have effect. That is why it has to be heard from the lips of a pure devotee. That is why I keep telling all of you, have chanting box in your houses. Put Srila Prabhupada's chanting 24/7 going on in the house. So it has to be heard from the lips of a pure devotee, not from somebody who is making money out of this thinking in the public. Okay, Srila Prabhupada, in Hare Krishna Mahamantra lecture, the meaning of the mantra, he explains this. Because hearing it from the lips of non-devotee is like tasting the milk which is touched by the lips of a serpent. So hard he goes. Okay, so let's go forward. Who wants to read? Annapurna Mataji, you would like to read?
Yes, Mataji. Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
There is a spiritual sky. There is another nature which is beyond the manifestation and non-manifestation. But how will you know that there is a sky where planets and inhabitants are eternal? All this knowledge is there, but how will you make experiments? It is not possible. Therefore, you have to take the assistance of Vedas. This is called Vedic knowledge. In our Krishna consciousness movement, we are accepting knowledge from the highest authority, Krishna. Krishna is accepted as the highest authority by all classes of men. I am speaking first of the two classes of transcendentalists. One class of transcendentalists is called impersonalist Mayavadi. They are generally known as Vedantists, led by Shankaracharya. And there is another class of transcendentalists called Vaishnavas, like Ramanujachari, Madhavachari, Vishnu Swami. Both the Shankara Sampradaya and Vaishnava Sampradaya have accepted Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Shankaracharya is supposed to be an impersonalist who preached impersonalism, impersonal Brahma, but it is the fact that he is covered personalist. In his commentary on Bhagavad Gita, he wrote, Narayana, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is beyond this cosmic manifestation. And then again he confirmed that the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Narayana, is Krishna. He has come as the son of Devaki and Vasudeva. He has particularly mentioned the names of his father and mother. So Krishna is accepted as the Supreme Personality of Godhead by all the transcendentalists. There is no doubt about it. Our source of knowledge in Krishna consciousness is directly from Krishna, Bhagavad Gita. We have published the Bhagavad Gita as it is because we accept Krishna as he is speaking without any interpretation. That is Vedic knowledge. Since the Vedic knowledge is pure, we accept it. Whatever Krishna says, we accept. This is Krishna consciousness. That saves much time. If you accept the right authority or the source of knowledge, then you save much time. For example, there are two systems of knowledge in the material world, inductive and deductive. From deductive, you accept that man is mortal. Your father says man is mortal. Your sister says man is mortal. Everyone says man is mortal, but you do not experiment. You accept it as a fact that man is mortal. If you want to research to find out whether man is mortal, you have to study each and every man, and you may come to think that there may be some man who is not dying, but you have not seen him yet. So in this way, your research will never be finished. This process in Sanskrit, Aroha, the ascending process. If you want to attain knowledge by any personal endeavor, by exercising your imperfect senses, you will never come to the right conclusion. That is not possible. There is a statement in Brahma Samhita, just ride on the aeroplane which runs at the speed of mind. Our material airplanes can run 2000 miles per hour. But what is speed of mind? You are sitting at home, you immediately think of India, say 10,000 miles away, and at once it is in your home. Your mind has gone there. The mind speed is so swift. Therefore, it is stated, if you travel at this speed for millions of years, you will find that the spiritual sky is unlimited. It is not possible even to approach it. Therefore, the Vedic injunction is that one must approach. The word compulsory is used a bona fide spiritual master, a guru. And what is the qualification of a spiritual master? He has readily heard the Vedic message from the right source. Otherwise, he is not a bona fide. He must practically be firmly established in Brahman. There are two qualities. This Krishna conscious moment is completely authorized from Vedic principles. In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, the actual aim of Vedic research is to find out Krishna. In Brahma Samhita, it is also stated, Krishna, Govinda has innumerable forms, but they are all one. They are not like our forms, which are fallible. His form is infallible. My form has a beginning, but his form has no beginning. It is Ananta. And his form, so many multi forms, has no end. My form is sitting here and not in an apartment. You are sitting there and not in your apartment. But Krishna can be everywhere at one time. He can sit down in Goloka Vrindavana, and at the same time, he is everywhere, all pervading. He is original, the oldest. But whenever you look at a picture of Krishna, you will find a young boy, 15 to 20 year old. You will never find an old man. You have seen pictures of Krishna as a charioteer from Bhagavad Gita. At that time, he was not less than 100 years old. He had great grandchildren, but he looked just like a boy. Krishna, God, never becomes old. That is his supreme power. And if you want to search out Krishna by studying the Vedic literature, then you will be baffled. It may be possible, but it is very difficult. But you can easily learn about him from his devotees. His devotee can deliver him to you. Here he is. Take him. That is the potency of Krishna's devotees.
Thank you, Mataji.
Yes.
Very nice. So we studied that there are three kinds of evidences of three kinds of modes of acquiring knowledge. Shabda Brahman, Prataksha Brahman, and Anuman Brahman. And then Prabhupada is saying our Krishna consciousness movement is directly related, is directly from Krishna. So we hear it. Vedic knowledge is heard by a bona fide source. And he goes on to explain inductive and deductive. Deductive means descending process. Like it is the, you have been given the final conclusion. by someone else's observation or experiment or inference. So you just accept it. You save time in it. Inductive means you go on experimenting on yourself. Like Prabhupada is giving an example of someone wants to know that if man is mortal or not. A sane man will just accept, yes, it is, because there is so much evidence around me. But someone may be like, okay, there is a man who is not mortal, but I just have to find that one person out of billions and billions of people around me. Then they lose time. So this process, this ascending process, it will never be finished. We can never finish. I'm sorry, I said inductive, deductive, separate. Deductive process is ascending process, which is not recommended. That you make an observation first and then you experiment and then you come to a conclusion. It's going to have a lot of defect. But on the contrary, axiomatic truth means that you accept the inference first. You accept the conclusion first that man is mortal. Okay, and then you live by that principle and then you realize it. And then how do you validate your inference? From the Shastras. Krishna says, Dukhalyam Ashashvatam. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Abrahma Bhuvanar Loka Punar Avartina Arjuna. And Krishna uses the word Janma Mrityu Jara Vyadhi Dukha Doshanu Darshanam. So many evidences are given. But if I don't believe in that word, then I have to go on experimenting and I'll never finish the experiment and I'll lose the time. And the speed of mind is very swift. This is very elaborately explained in Brahma Samhita. This Panthastha Koti Satavat Sarasam Pragamyo Vayo Rathapi Manaso Munipungavana. This verse that Prabhupada is saying here, that mind speed is very swift. I am sitting here and I want to go to my room in my parents' house in India and put that particular cupboard to get that particular thing out already there. We all have that power given to us by Krishna. Already there. The mind is already there. So even if we are running at that speed, we will still not be able to go to the transcendental world. So my senior students who are sitting in this class, can you tell me what are the two worlds explained by Krishna? One is, I don't want to say the answer, because if I say the answer, then that's the answer. My question is, what are the two worlds? One is what we are seeing and another is what is beyond us. So what are the names used for those worlds? You can unmute yourself, co-host, give me a reference from Bhagavad Gita and give me the Sanskrit word. That is the standard I want to see from you. The people who are older or senior, not older, but seniors. Yes. What are the words? Oh, Madhurani, Hare Krishna.
Krishna Mataji. Is it para and apara?
Very nice. Para and apara. So what is the meaning?
Or pratyaksha means and another is a spiritual.
Para is para and apara. So para is what I can see and apara is which is beyond my vision. Or vyakta, avyakta. Vyakta, avyakta. Fallible and infallible. Or para and apara is material world and spiritual world. So para means fallible, which is material world. Apara means which is beyond this. Very nice. Thank you. Yes. So Krishna, spiritual world is beyond our vision. We cannot see nearby planets. We need so much help. And that too has been seen very imperfectly. They discover one planet and then they say, no, that's not a planet. Like Pluto, I'm hearing it's not a planet anymore. So it's so imperfect, then how can we talk about Krishna's planet? Where even if we are running at the speed of the mind, we still cannot reach that world. So what we are trying to do over here is hearing from a bona fide source is very important. And one must approach. There are some rules in communication. I keep on saying all these things again and again. So one rule is that the words like must, should, have to are orders. The orders. It's not that by mistake Prabhupada is saying it. No. He's saying it because it's an order. One must approach the bona fide. It's compulsory for a person who is a human being. Compulsory to approach a spiritual master and learn the truth. But how do we know who is a spiritual master? Two qualities. One is they are themselves they are themselves in the disciplic succession, and then their practice or their achar Sadachar is going to be in alignment with that disciplic succession. First is they belong to the disciplic succession, and second is that their behavior and their activity is going to be in the line of that succession. They're not going to make up new things. They're not going to be self-acclaimed guru. The guru is not going to exploit another person for their own well-being. No, it doesn't happen that way. It does not. The sannyasi is dependent on Krishna, or a guru is dependent on Krishna. The sannyasi, it's not necessary that a sannyasi has to be a guru. But a person who's on the platform of becoming someone else's guru is only dependent on Krishna. They're not dependent on anyone else. Okay, so the actual aim of Krishna, actual aim of Vedic knowledge is to find out Krishna. Vedeshcha sarve ahameva vedya. So 15th chapter, 15th verse. Vedeshcha sarve ahameva vedya. Vedantakrit vedavit eva chaham. Now the curiosity will be pacified, the difference between Vedic knowledge and Upanishads and Puranas and Itihas. Yes, Khushbu Mataji, may I ask you to read?
Yes, Mataji.
Thank you.
I'll continue.
Yeah, originally there was one Veda.
Originally, there was only one Veda, and there was no necessity for reading it. People were so intelligent and had such sharp memories that by once hearing from the lips of the spiritual master, they would understand. They would immediately grasp the whole purport. But 5,000 years ago, Vyas Ved put the Vedas in writing for the people in this age, Kali Yuga. He knew that eventually the people would be short-lived, the memories would be very poor, and the intelligence would not be very sharp. Therefore, let me teach this Vedic knowledge in writing. He divided the Vedas into four, Arke, Sama, Atharva, and Yajus. Then he gave the charge of these Vedas to his different disciples. He then thought of the less intelligent class of men, Stri, Sudra, and Dvijbandhu. He considered the woman class and Shudra class, that is worker class, and Dvijbandhu. Dvijbandhu refers to those who are born in a high family, but who are not properly qualified. A man who is born in the family of Brahmana, but is not qualified as a Brahmana, is called Dvijbandhu. For these persons, he compiled the Mahabharata, called the History of India, and the 18 Puranas. These are all the part of the Vedic literature, the Puranas, the Mahabharata, the four Vedas, and the Upanishads. The Upanishads are the part of the Vedas. Then Vyas Ved summarized all this Vedic knowledge for scholars and philosophers in what is called the Vedanta Sutra. This is the last word of the Vedas. Vyasdev personally wrote the Vedanta Sutra under the instructions of Narada, his Guru Maharaj, spiritual master, but still he was not satisfied. That is a long story described in Srimad Bhagavat. Vedyas was not very satisfied even after compiling many Puranas, Upanishads, and even after writing the Vedanta Sutra. Then his spiritual master Narada instructed him, "You explain the Vedanta. Vedanta means the ultimate knowledge, and the ultimate knowledge is Krishna. Krishna says that throughout all the Vedas, one has to understand Krishna. Vedanta, Vida, Vid, Eva, Cham. Krishna says, I'm the compiler of the Vedanta and I am the knower of the Vedas. Therefore, the ultimate objective is Krishna. That is explained in all the Vaishnava commentaries on Vedanta philosophy. We, Gaudiya Vaishnavas, have a commentary on Vedanta philosophy called Govinda Bhasya by Baldev Vidyabhushana. Similarly, Ramanujacharya has commentary and Madhavacharya has one. The version of Shankaracharya is not the only commentary. There are many Vedanta commentaries, but because the Vaishnavas did not present the first Vedanta commentary, people are under the wrong impression that Shankaracharya's is the only Vedanta commentary. Besides that, Vyasdev himself wrote the perfect Vedanta commentary. Srimad Bhagavatam also begins with the first words of the Vedanta Sutra, Janmadasya Yataha. And that Janmadasya Yataha is fully explained in Srimad Bhagavatam. The Vedanta Sutra simply hints at what is Brahman, the absolute truth. The absolute truth is that from whom everything emanates. This is a summary, but it's explained in detail in Srimad Bhagavatam. If everything is emanating from the absolute truth, then what is the nature of the absolute truth? That is explained in Srimad Bhagavatam. The absolute truth must be conscious. Swarat, he is self-effulgent. We develop a consciousness and knowledge by receiving knowledge from others. But for him, it is said that he is self-effulgent. The whole summary of Vedic knowledge is the Vedanta Sutra, and the Vedanta Sutra is explained by the writer himself in Srimad Bhagavatam. We finally request those who are actually after Vedic knowledge to try to understand the explanation of all the Vedic knowledge from Srimad Bhagavatam and the Bhagavad Gita.
Thank you so much, Ma'am. So, Srila Prabhupada is saying that first there was only one Veda, but the people in Kali Yuga have these qualifications, short-lived, memories are poor, and intelligence is not very sharp. This is chapter number first canto, Srimad Bhagavatam, first chapter, verse number 10. This is written over there. Short-lived, memories are poor, intelligence is not very sharp. So for them, we asked to compassion and divided one Veda into four classes. So he wrote it down now. And then he gave it to his disciples, each Veda, to carry it forward. And this word, we have to understand, Dvija Bandhu. Dvija Bandhu means, Dvija means twice born. One birth is by the parents, father and mother. And another birth is by the Vedic knowledge and the spiritual master. So as a human being is supposed to have two births. One birth by the father and mother, and another one by the spiritual master and the Vedic knowledge. So someone can be born in a family of a Dvija or Brahmana, but that birth itself is not making them Brahmana. And if they are not qualified, if they don't entail the qualification of a Brahmana, then they are called as a friend of a Brahmana. Dvija Bandhu. Bandhu means friend. Bandhu, Surat and Mitra. There are three classes of friendships described in Bhagavad Gita. So Bandhu is like, okay, I'm just your friend, but I'm not a Brahmana. Okay, so Mahabharata was compiled for less intelligent people, further less intelligent, so they can understand. They can understand the Vedic knowledge in the form of a story. But it is a historical fact. It's not that it's a fiction. It's not a fiction. It's a historical fact. And then 18 Puranas were subdivided. So he wrote so much. He wrote four Vedas. He wrote Mahabharata. He wrote Puranas, 18 Puranas. But he wrote Upanishads also. So, but he was still not satisfied. Vedvyas was still not happy. So he asked his spiritual master with Narad Muni that I have written the Vedic knowledge. I have written the Puranas. I have written the Mahabharatas. I have written the Upanishads. But I'm still not happy. So Narad Muni told him, you're not happy because you're not describing the past tense of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna. So he asked him to write Vedanta Sutra. Vedanta Sutra, Veda Anta. Anta means end. So end of knowledge. Then he compiled Srimad Bhagavatam. Srimad Bhagavatam is the final word of all the Vedic literature. Srimad Bhagavatam Amalam Puranam. Srimad Bhagavatam is the cream of all the Vedic knowledge. You know, when we have a milk which is rich in cream, and you boil it, and then the cream comes on top after the milk cools down, and that is the best part of the milk. Like that, Srimad Bhagavatam is the cream of all the Vedic knowledge. Amalam Puranam. Srimad Bhagavatam is compared to a ripened mango fruit. Srimad Bhagavatam is so sweet. It's like a fruit. But because it is spoken by the lotus mouth of Sukadeva Goswami, so there also they have given so many analogies. For example, let's say there is a guava. And when guava is touched by the beak of a parrot, that particular guava becomes more sweet. So this Srimad Bhagavatam, because it is coming from the lotus lips of Sukadeva Goswami, that it has become more sweet. It is sweet, but because Sukadeva Goswami is speaking it, Sukadeva Goswami is speaking it, it becomes more sweet. So Vedanta Sutra. So if anyone has to read and make their life perfect, then read Srimad Bhagavatam. Please read Srimad Bhagavatam. We analyze, if we read one verse a day, it will take 70 years to complete. 70 years. So please read Srimad Bhagavatam every day. And Srimad Bhagavatam describes this first, Janmadhyasya Yatha Anva Itiratascha Artesha Vijnana Swarat. Krishna is Janmadhyasya Yatha, means he's the absolute truth. And he is completely independent. Anyway, I'll summarize. In this lecture, Srila Prabhupada is, first of all, the beginning is, what are the Vedas? Vedas means knowledge. And then he's saying that the imperfect human being cannot give the perfect knowledge. Why? Because there are four imperfections. And four imperfections are, tendency to commit mistakes, we are illusioned, and we have imperfect senses, and we have cheating propensity. So we cannot give. So where to go then? Where to go to accept the perfect knowledge? To a bona fide spiritual master. So how to achieve a perfect knowledge? Is it by Anuman Praman? Is it by Pratyaksha Praman? Or is it by Shabda Praman? Yes, who will tell me? How to achieve a perfect knowledge? Is it by Anuman Praman, Shabda Praman, or Shruti Praman, hearing? People who have not answered even once, yes. Yeah, and rest of you, please write to me. I'm reading that also. Reshma Mataji. Yes, Mataji.
How do we...
Yes, Sai Krishna.
Shabda Praman, Mataji.
Very nice.
Thank you.
Shabda Praman. So, Shabda Praman from who? Anyone who thinks that they're a guru and we go to them and acquire knowledge, or is there a system? Yes. Shanta Mataji. Who is bona fide to give us the Shabda Praman? Shanta Mataji, you can unmute yourself. Okay, Chitra Mataji, yes.
To decide like succession from bona fide guru.
Bona fide guru who belongs to our disciplic succession. Very nice. Yes. So you have to find out a bona fide guru who belongs to our disciplic succession. So everything is given to us. We just have to live these instructions. The instructions are given. How to live, where to go, what to do. Guide is there. Okay. So Shruti is compared to the mother. If I want to know who is my father, the best way to ask the mother. And whatever mother says is perfect. All right. And then in the last part of the lecture, Srila Prabhupada is saying that what is Upanishads? Upanishads are the part of Vedas. And why did Vyasadeva write Upanishads? Why did Vyasadeva divide Vedas into four subdivisions? Yes, you can write to me. Whose behavior is in alignment with it? Very nice. Whose belongs to the succession? Very nice. So why did Vyasadeva divide the Vedas into four subcategories? There was only one Veda in the beginning. Priya Mataji. Priya B.
Yeah, Hare Krishna Mataji. Dhanvat Pranam.
Dhanvat Pranam.
So since you told of Srimad Bhagavatam 1.1.10 that Prayane Alpa Ayusha Manda Sumanda Matyo Manda Bhagya Upudita, so that is the reason.
Yeah. Why don't you tell us in a simple language? Because not yeah, many
so people are short-lived, quarrelsome, lazy, misguided, memories are poor, intelligence is not very sharp. So all these are the reasons.
Yes, so Vyasadeva took compassion upon us and then he wrote it down. And then he wrote 18 Puranas, and then he wrote Mahabharata, and then he wrote Upanishads. Upanishads are the headlines of the Vedas. They you know how we, in the newspaper, there is a headline and then there is news underneath. The Upanishads are like that. A reference that, okay, this particular aphorism, go to this particular chapter, this particular thing. So he wrote it for us, but he was still not satisfied. Then what happened? He was still not satisfied. Then what did Narad Muni tell him to do? Yes, Neha Mataji.
Then Hare Krishna, Narad Muni told him that. Narad Muni told him to write about Vedanta Sutra, Amalam, yes. Puranam.
What is the best Amalam Puranam or Vedanta Sutra commentary?
Srimad Bhagavatam.
Very nice. So, very nice. So, should we all read Bhagavatam in our lifetime? I'm going to ask you all to unmute, okay, and tell me collectively. Should we all read Srimad Bhagavatam or should we all just...
Yes,
we have to.
Yes,
Mataji,
study. Mataji, I'm going to buy soon.
Yes, Mataji.
Yes, ma'am, we have to.
Yes,
Mataji.
Yes, Mataji.
Thank you very much. So, we are going to do some questions. Okay, this is a very big graph which tells that Shruti and Smriti, there are two aspects of understanding Vedic knowledge. Let's go down to the Smriti route first because that came first. Smriti means memory, memorizing. So, there are five subdivisions, rituals, sutras, tantras, puranas, itihas, and shaddarshana. And composed by sages, wording may change from age to age, written in classical Sanskrit. So Mahabharata comes under Smriti Puran, under the subsection of Itihas, which is also considered as a fifth Veda. I don't think you have to understand because it's, Prabhupada doesn't emphasize it so much. But in Mahabharata, so Mahabharata is considered as a fifth, as a Itihas. Itihas is also under Smriti Praman, Smriti Prasthan. Smriti Prasthan is which is remembered by the Vedas in the form of these. So Mahabharata is Smriti Prasthan, considered as a fifth Veda. And in Smriti Prasthan, most important section is, on Mahabharata, most important section is Bhagavad Gita. And another Itihas is Ramayana. Okay, so we have two most important, Mahabharata and Ramayana. And in Mahabharata, we pay much attention to Bhagavad Gita. This is our interest. Now, in Shruti Praman, because Vedic knowledge is Shabda Praman, by hearing, right? So, Shruti Praman is revealed absolute truth. Every word is unchanged, eternally written by the Vedics in Vedic Sanskrit. So, there are four Vedas, Rig, Yajur, Atharv, and Sama Veda. And in Rig, Yajur and Sama, more subdivisions are given. And Atharva Veda talks about something else. In that way, it gets very complicated. This is very Shastric slide. But I just wanted to bring to your attention that Upanishads that we are reading one of the Upanishads called as Isopanishad. Upanishad is a Vedic knowledge, which comes under the category of Shruti Praman or Shruti Prasthan. Means we cannot experiment it. You got to understand what you're going to read from now on. Okay? On the other hand, Mahabharata or Ramayana is considered as a Smriti Prasthan. Smriti Prasthan is something which is which happened. It's like saying a historical fact. It's a historical fact. We have evidences. It's like that, okay, this thing happened. But Shruti Praman, we don't have evidence. We have to hear it. Okay? So we are going to read a very high level knowledge. So don't get bored in the middle, please. Next time I'll just make slides and bring to you. But it's important to read Prabhupada's words. It's very important. So let's do some questions. You're going to have to raise your hand. What is the meaning of the word Veda? Why don't you type it? Type it fast and then raise your hand, whoever wants to. People who have not answered even once are only requested to raise hands. People who have answered once, please refrain from raising hand and type it. Because everyone should get chance. Yes, Abhita, Mataji. What is the meaning of the word Vedas according to what we read today?
Veda means knowledge, Mataji.
Very nice, very nice. Okay, 100 out of 100. So who's going to tell me? The four defects of a conditioned soul. Even my co-hosts have not answered. Yes, Vasant Kumar Prabhu, four defects of a conditioned soul.
Yes, Mataji.
Yes.
Yeah, the four defects as mentioned in this is, one is the commit mistake. One must commit mistakes. The second one is to be illusioned. The third defect is the cheating propensity. The last one is our senses are imperfect.
Very, very nice. List three pramanas. What are the three pramanas or three ways of acquiring knowledge? Yes, Very nice, you all are typing too. Please type and please raise your hand. Three Pramanas, Utkarsh Tripathi, Hare Krishna. What are the three Pramanas? Three ways of acquiring knowledge. Okay, 108, Hare Krishna. Neetu Mataji, okay, you go Mataji. Neetu yeah. Mataji.
So, Pratishna, Anumana, Shabda.
Okay, thank you. Yes, Dr. Parik, yes.
Pratyaksha Pramana, Anumana Pramana, and Sabda Pramana.
Can you please tell the meanings?
Pratyaksha Pramana is something that you see in front of your eyes.
Yes. Anumana
Pramanam is the hypothesis, and Sabda Pramana is the word that comes from the spiritual master with disciplinic order.
Succession, very nice. Thank you. Okay, give reasons why Shabda Pramana is superior means of acquiring knowledge. Yes. What are the reasons? You can type it. Simmi Mataji. Yes, Mataji. Where are you? Yes, Mataji. Why is Shabda Pramana the best way of acquiring knowledge?
That's because it's coming from a bona fide guru.
Bona fide guru. Okay, number one then. Okay. So what, just explain the quality of a bona fide guru. Who is a bona fide guru? Yes, let me read the chat.
Who's got all the opulences?
What, Mataji?
Who has all the opulences of...
Okay, bona fide guru is enough. Bona fide guru. Yes, who's going to tell me what's a bona fide guru? How do you know this guru is bona fide? Somebody can come in off the street and say, I'm guru. But how do you test the authenticity? You know how we test the authenticity of the gold, right? That what is that KDM or what is the trademark? So how do you, what is the seal of a bona fide guru? Yes, Mita Mataji.
I first want to ask you about in Prabhu.
Wait, I'm not in the question answer yet. First you answer my question.
Achha. Your answer was about the question you asked is Shabda Praman, right?
How do you know this particular person is a bona fide guru?
Because he's the only authority.
How do you know his authority? Go more deep. Very nice. Your answer is right. His authority, right? But let's see. Okay, Surya Mahalaksh. How do you know this is a bona fide guru? Srita Mataji rightly said that he's the authority. But how do you know that's the authority? What further test are you going to do? Yes. Surya Laksh Mahalaksh. Okay, he lowered his hand. Dyuti Mataji, yes, Dyuti Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Yes, Hare Krishna.
Yes, Mataji, first of all, they have to be in the disciplic succession.
Yes.
And their behavior has to be in the disciplic succession as well.
Very nice. Very Thank nice. You, Excellent. So yes, how do I know this person is a bona fide guru? Because they are themselves in a disciplic succession. Just by being in the disciplic succession makes them bona fide? No. They have to practice what they're preaching. Their behavior and then their habits and activities has to be in alignment with the disciplic succession. That is a bona fide guru. Okay, list two systems of knowledge in the material world. Bummer, right? Two systems of knowledge in the material world. Yes. My co-host who has not answered, please encourage me. You are promoted to the standard of co-host, but who has not answered today? Pankaj Apte Prabhu, yes, two systems of knowledge in the material world. What are they?
Shruti and Smruti.
Those are the two ways.
Two ways.
So here the question is two systems of knowledge. Yes, but that's a good one. Thank you. Mahi Pratibhan, yes. Unmute, please, Mahi.
Inductive and deductive, Mataji.
Inductive and deductive is correct. Good. And also, we can say inductive and deductive are system of knowledge is personalist and impersonalist. People who believe in the personal form of Krishna and who want to nullify Krishna's energy. But inductive and deductive is the right answer. What are the two qualifications of a bona fide guru? This 100% of the class should be able to answer. What are the two qualifications of a bona fide guru? I am reading the chats. I have not received any chat according to this yet. Yes, who's going to tell me? Utkarsh Tripathi, I keep asking you to unmute, but you don't unmute. Yes, please speak. Okay, Madhukar, KS, yes. Two qualifications of a bona fide guru.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
Yes, Hare Krishna.
Mataji, he should be in the parampara and he should be realized in knowledge.
He should be in the parampara and he should be practicing that knowledge. Yes.
Practicing the knowledge and he should act like a transparent medium between the source and the devotee.
Very nice. Yes.
Hare.
Okay, so I think we finished this introduction only. I did not do invocation today. So invocation, I'll just make the slideshow. I wanted to read Prabhupada's lecture with all of you because his words are very potent. So we can take some questions for another 10 minutes or so. And then we will meet again on 28th. Is it 28th? Yes.
That's right, ma'am. 28th.
Okay. Thank you. Very nice. Mahi Pratibha, we are writing, heard knowledge from right source and be format established in Brahman. Very nice. So anyone has any questions? There's so many hands raised. Now, I don't know whether they're question or not. Smita Mataji.
Yeah, in Prabhupada's lecture, what you read, women have been described as Shudras. I couldn't get it.
Yeah, so that's a very, we have to understand Prabhupada's words in essence. The problem happens is that we understand Prabhupada's word by our experience. Prabhupada is saying, no, he's just not saying woman, he's saying Shudra. And in Kali Yuga, everyone. Kalo Shudra Sambhava. Kaliyuga, everyone is a born Shudra. Why? Because everyone is looking for a job. Everyone is trying to serve someone. Okay? And then, in that way, everyone, not just women. And then he also says, Dvija Bandhu, the friend of a Brahmana. So he's saying three people. And he's not saying, he's actually, Krishna himself says in 9th chapter, this thing. I think it's verse number 34 that Prabhupada is right, say, quoting over here. So who wants to answer this question? Yes, one of my co-admins. Srila Prabhupada is saying, we have had this discussion many times now in different classes. Yes, Sita Mataji, you have been here almost always. So when Prabhupada is saying that women, Shudra, Dvija Bandhu are less intelligent, what does he mean? Where are you? Yes.
I don't think that he's trying to, bring down women in any aspects. I don't know if I can give any reference, but what you had mentioned was everybody that is born in Kali Yuga is a Shudra. So I'm not seeing any like a discriminatory statement against women in this regard, Mataji. So I'm not sure if I can add on anything more. It's plain and simple. It said everybody's a Shudra. And you know, at the end of the day, what we're learning is what is the essence of what is being taught and not nitpick on one or two things that we are thinking from our materialistic, understanding of it.
Very nice. Yes, thank you so much. So Smita Mataji, Prabhupada is not saying that women are inferior. There's a difference. He's saying women are less intelligent. And if you read Kardamuni's verdict on the behavior of a woman, it's like a child. He explains in Third Canto Srimad Bhagavatam to his wife Devahuti before he retires that it's like a child. A woman needs protection. That's her psychological nature. What are you going to do about it? Is there two different people? Man is different, woman is different. Krishna made that way. So woman needs protection. When she is a young child, she should be protected by the elders in the house of father. Then when she's young, the good husband, not a fallen husband, not any person called with the label of husband. No. Qualifications are needed. And when she's older, then it's by her grown up children. So when she's protected, then she can nurture her qualities. And what are the qualities? What are the seven qualities of Krishna in a woman? What are the seven qualities of Krishna in a woman? Who's going to tell me? I'm asking you question on top of question. fame, fortune, fortitude, patience, speech, fine speech, memory. Did I cover all seven? Fame, fortune, fine speech, patience, steadfastness, and memory. And there's one more, fortitude, I think. So these are the seven qualities of a woman. They can only be harnessed if she is given a proper environment. If she is left over to be exploited by the society, then Arjuna says in first chapter of Bhagavad Gita, she is so powerful that she will give birth to Varna Shankara, unwanted population. But if a woman is kept nicely, she's protected, her nature is nurtured, she's taught religious activity, then she's so powerful that she'll give birth to Varnashrama, a very, very eligible Krishna conscious population. So it really depends on how we harness and how we cultivate these qualities in them. Do you think the Draupadi, Mother Kunti, they were very qualified women? They had so many qualities in them that general women of today's world don't even know about, and they had it. But they were also showing the example that they need to be under the care of the bona fide husband. Queen Kunti was not told to go to the exile, but she went. Why? Because she was following the order of a womanly class and elevating herself. So it's not that Prabhupada is saying inferior. I also understood that way 19 years ago. It's that he's saying that women are less intelligent. They need to be protected. Children are less intelligent. They need to be protected like that. Okay, don't take it wrong. But Prabhupada in Queen Kunti prayers, if you come to our Sadhu Sangha classes on Saturday where we are reading Srimad Bhagavatam, Queen Kunti's prayers, he writes in one of the prayers that if a woman tries to become Krishna conscious authentically, she can be as good as Queen Kunti. Okay, a woman, if she tries to go to Krishna consciousness under the care of a bona fide spiritual master and acharyas, she can preach all the so-called men of the whole world. Okay, yes, Kushbu Mataji. Okay, Mataji.
Mataji, my Varnashrama is basically this. It is addressed as human society, or it is only for the people who read Vedas. I mean, I got a bit confused with that.
No. Veda, Varna and Ashrama is made of two words. First, to understand.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Varna means occupation. Occupation, Brahmana, Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. What Varna are we in? That's occupational division. Okay. And corresponding to the occupation, there is a spiritual order. Spiritual order is like Brahmana. So Brahmachari, Brahmachari, Grihastha, Vanaprastha, and Sannyas. So there is a system in place given by Krishna for the entire human society, not just people who study Vedas. The whole human society is supposed to be divided into Varna and Ashrama. For example, some of us have natural inclination to study Vedic scriptures. We are naturally inclined to Vedic, to Brahminical qualities. Not that I am getting it from somewhere else. Right? So that person has to be harnessed, that quality has to be nurtured. And that person may become a Brahmana or a Sannyasi or anything. Like, they can have Brahminical qualities. Some people have by birth leadership qualities. Qualities of resourcefulness, quality of doing taxes exploiting, but it's detail, fighting, giving protection. Some people have that. So they are Kshatriya Guna. We have to harness them as a Kshatriya. Not that because this person is born to a Brahmana father, he can only be a Brahmana or she can only be a Brahmana. No. Okay, so, or somebody has a quality of just doing business, trading, banking, mercantile. That's Vaishya quality. Maybe born to a Brahmana father, but their quality is this natural quality. Then they have to be harnessed in that sense. Why do we have to do it? So that we can become Krishna conscious by doing our own occupational duty.
Okay. Mataji.
Yeah.
Mataji, then Eklavya was, I'm just asking as an example to clarify. Eklavya was not from Kshatriya, but he possessed the quality of a Kshatriya. He wanted to be, he was very good, he was a very good archer. But how, like, is this all, that could be connected with Varnashrama also, is that point?
I don't know the pastime of Ekalavya. You have to tell me more.
Mataji, he was an archer who considered Dronacharya as his disciple. And he, just by creating a statue of Dronacharya, used to practice, like considering that my guru is watching me and guiding me. But then Dronacharya...
So he asked for his thumb. So yeah. So he can be considered a Kshatriya, yes, by birth. But unless and until someone is completely nurtured by a bona fide guru, we cannot just for example, somebody can have a very natural inclination to be a teacher. Some children are like that, right? They want to teach. They like to teach to other children. They want to be a teacher. Unless and until they go to a proper school, proper college, proper teacher is giving them training, they are not considered as a bona fide teacher, right? They may have inclination, but they are not yet bona fide. Correct?
Okay.
So even if he had the qualities, I don't think he was under a proper shelter of Dronacharya. Don't think he approached him in a proper manner. So I don't know. There's a gap there. And I'm not the proper person to comment on that. Okay.
Okay, Mataji. Actually, it was a quite detailed term, Varnashrama. So I was getting a little confused with
the topic. It's a very detailed topic. Very, very detailed topic. But the principle is simple. The principle is not by birth, but by natural qualities.
Okay.